Hey, good afternoon. For anyone on the East Coast, good morning on the West Coast. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Joe Young. I'm with the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety. And joining me today is Griff Jones. And we are here to talk to you about the IIHS-HLDI in the classroom online learning website, which was designed with the idea of teaching the science behind car crashes. So in a moment, we are going to actually go through and give you a quick walkthrough of the site and how to use it. We know a lot of you are now all of a sudden homeschooling, looking for quality resources that are online-based that don't require a lot of supplies or materials. And best of all, I would add the site is totally free. And Griff helped us design this site. Just to give you a quick background on Griff, he's a classroom teacher for 20 years. And then more recently was a professor of education at the University of Florida, where he's still a professor emeritus, and has won several awards. So Griff, I wanted to ask you what grades you taught, what classes and subjects you taught when you were teaching.
Well, thanks, Joe. Well, first of all, I'd like to say welcome to everyone. And we know these are difficult times and we really appreciate you tuning in. We think we can give you a lot of great resources today. The grades that I taught in my 20 years as a classroom teacher, grades from grades 3 all the way up to grade 12, high school. I was at the University of Florida's laboratory school, and it was a K-12 school. So it was a wonderful place to teach. And for my 20 years of teaching, each day I taught, half the day I taught mostly high school physics, and the other half the day I was the elementary science lab instructor. So I got to be the kind of the Bill Nye guy for the elementary grades, which was just a fantastic time.
That's great, Griff. And I guess we should ask why you are coming to us from your vehicle, it looks like.
Yeah, as you can see, this is my little classroom. Well, I actually live about 10 miles or so outside of Gainesville, where the University of Florida is located. Which is nice. We live kind of out in the country, which is great for social distancing. Look, I even have my Go Gator face mask. But the problem is my Wi-Fi is bad, and signal is just so weak. It's awful. And then same way with my cell signal. So we wanted to do this live, obviously, from my house, but it just wasn't working. Well, so best thing I could do was get in the car and drive a couple of miles towards town to where I got a good phone signal. And so I'm just kind of parked in a shopping center parking lot and coming that way.
Well, we appreciate you joining us, and we all got to kind of do what we can right now, right? So again, we're about to just take a quick look at the IIHS-HLDI in the classroom website. We've got demonstration videos and hands-on activities and some other great resources there that were all developed with Griff and with the University of Florida as well. Can you talk at all about how UF was involved with developing the site?
Yeah, well, we've known for years by working with the Institute that we wanted to get everything that we had made to that point online. It was just how to go about doing it. And my last few years at the university, I was working with a design team that developed online learning courses, websites, and so on for the university. And I was able to enlist them to help us and, me and the Institute to put all of our learning materials and our two videos and more material online. And so that everything played out perfectly because these guys are at the best at what they do. And so it was wonderful to have enlist them to use their expertise and allow us to build a really what we think is a very innovative site that is geared to being used not only in the classroom through the web, but also at home. So it's working out well that we feel like we really have something we can contribute during these difficult times for students, as well as parents and then teachers in the online courses. So we feel like we can cover a lot of bases. That was our intent. We never realized it was going to be something that this dramatic, but we're hoping that we can really lend our resources to everyone's at home schooling efforts.
That's great, Griff. Well, thanks for that. And I think we're going to go ahead and take a look at the site in just a second. While we're running through and taking a look at how the site works and the best way to use the resources while you're at home teaching, if you've got questions, please drop them if you're on Facebook in the comments section or on YouTube in the chat section. And we'll answer some of those questions here live in just a moment. So Griff, I think we're just going to give a quick overview of the site. And I think, is there anything you want to add before we jump right in?
Well, only quick thing I would add is that one of the things that we tried to do with the UF team is that to look at the research that we realized that the best way to attract and keep people's attention, particularly students, is to do things like we called it chunking, which is a non-technical term in the education world, but we wanted to keep things short. So most of the videos that they will see, everything from our two main videos to all of the demo videos, the behind the scene tour videos, all of those we're keeping pretty short. Because that's what the research says in order to keep students' attention and to help them process all this information.
Wonderful. So, well, let's go ahead and take a look then.
Sounds great. Let's do the tour.
Let's start right here with our COVID-19 update for parents. We've updated our registration site so that once you log in, first you have to register and then you log in, you will have access to all the teacher materials. That includes all the answer keys and the teacher lesson plans. All right, let's get started. Let's start with a general flyover of the four main areas on the site. The first of four is sort of the backbone of the site, which is our understanding car crash videos. We have two videos, each a little over 20 minutes long. Both of them have instructional materials that go along to help the students gather and organize the concepts that we address in each video. First one's it's basic physics, the second when physics meets biology. They each have three different viewing options to allow for some instructional flexibility, which I'll show you here in a minute. Second of our four areas are our lessons. These are our hands-on inquiry-based lessons. We have 14 of these now. We just added three new ones. There's one there. And of the 14, 10 of them use very simple, easy to find household materials. Then we go to the third area. Here are engagement videos. These are shorter videos, or at least no more than 5 minutes long. Teachers like to use these videos at the beginning of a lesson in order to hook the students' interest, right? To get them captivated and interested in the science topic the teacher is going to, introduce. The first way we do that, we've included videos called Crash Science Demos. Here is where I do some cool science tricks, or we like to call them better discrepant events, because it's not what you're expecting to see. They each address a science topic. In this case, broom and egg looks at inertia. But then we have bowling ball pendulum. You can see it gives a running time, 2 minutes and 37 seconds. Apple and the rod, triple stress, looks at stress and strain on tissues. Mystery bottle looks at density and human tissue. Then we have curveball, twirling trays, both with circular motion, and one that looks at energy and heat, which are the crashing spheres. Now, if you scroll down, you'll see, just like in almost every activity or feature we have on here, you have tabs that show for the students and for the teachers. So this gives student directions. This allows the students to free explore the site and know what to do when they get to each different section in the site. And in this case, I'm trying to give them an outline how to view the videos. So we're asking them to predict what's going to happen before they actually watch what happens. So that's one thing you can encourage them to do. And then play it and observe the demonstration, and then try to figure out what happened. Now, for the teacher instructions, notice I click here and it says, please log in to your teacher account to access the teacher lesson plan. So let's go ahead and do that, because you're going to want to get to the teacher tips and the answer keys and so on. So first thing you're going to have to do is register. We've tried to keep it really simple. Put in your name, come up with a password, confirm it. And then if you would, please put the school name that your student goes to and their address. And subject you teach, you can say all of them at this moment. And then educational setting, you could say other for home, or you can also just put K-12 school. That's fine. And then the number of students per year, just hit the lesson 31. And then I'm not a robot, hit sign up, and you're good to go. Now, let me go ahead and log in. See, I've got it so it'll remember my password. So I only have to hit that once and I'm in as a teacher. And how you know that it was successful, because then when you click teacher, you see the instructions. So here we've given you instructions on the best ways to use the various resources, in this case, the demo videos. And here I'm explaining a little bit further that teaching technique that we call the POE technique, or PO, the predict, observe, explain. Very straightforward, sort of a simple way, but it gives a way for you to scaffold sort of your discussion with your child to look at the videos. Let's go back and look at the other engagement videos. Inside IIHS, one of my favorite areas, this has videos of behind-the-scenes tours. Again, most of them no more than 5 minutes long, but it gets at the work behind the scenes at the Vehicle Research Center. So the kids really find these interesting. So how they prepare a car for a crash test, and then how they actually propel them down the runways in order to hit the crash barrier, so the crash propulsion system. One of my favorites, the crash test photography. But there's a lot of nice ones in here. Crash test dummy is always a favorite. Some hidden gems are the one on research that shows just what types of research that happen at the Institute. And then as well as one that just was loaded up recently, the other branch of the Institute is the Highway Loss Data Institute, so or HLDI. So it's a neat little video that talks about what HLDI does. And then another engagement video is Crashworthiness Then and Now. This one, man, when this went on YouTube, it was a huge hit. It's what they did to celebrate their 50th anniversary. The Institute crashed a brand new car at the time, 2009 Chevy Malibu, into a 50-year-old 1959 Chevrolet Bel Air. They did it at 40 miles per hour, 40% offset crash. So not directly head-on, just they overlapped the front faces of the cars by 40%. And so to see just how far crashworthiness has come in those 50 years. So again, you ask the kids, don't show them the video right off the bat. Ask them which one they think is going to do best in the crash. You know, in this case, we mean, you know, be the most crashworthy, protect the dummy. So in fact, I walk you through here to tell you what to say before the video. Ask students to make predictions on what will happen. Got it there. And also you can download it here, a little sort of a bit of a lesson plan. Have them predict first, then show it to them, and then talk about why do you think they were so different. I'm not telling you the answer. You're going to have to find that one out on your own. That can be a fun way to actually start any lesson, particularly with some of their first lessons on crashworthiness. So those are their engagement videos. Let's move down to section number 4 in the last section. Here, students can take a little bit deeper dive into some crash safety topics, particularly now, how can cars avoid a crash? Another deep dive they can do is one of my favorite topics, since I was a high school teacher for 20 years, are the teen driving issues. And then the last area, this was fascinating to me, I had no idea about how some of the cars, even the same makes and models that are manufactured in different parts of the world, don't perform equally in a crash test. Okay, so there was our sort of flyover. A little dips into a few of the buckets or the resources. Now let's go back and do a deep dive into the main components, the understanding car crashes videos, and then we'll do the lessons. So the viewing options, what's that all about? Well, it's really to give you some instructional flexibility. They can watch the full video. It comes up on a player, and it's just like any YouTube player. You can start it and stop it however you want, okay? But then we made another version where we inserted pop-up questions for the students to answer as they go through the video. In fact, they have to answer them in order to proceed through the video. And these are really easy video content questions, pretty straightforward facts, just to make sure that they're paying attention, okay, and that they're understanding what they're hearing. Another one that teachers really like, if they don't want to watch the whole video because they don't have time in their lesson during that day, we've broken the video up into its segments. And then in each of the videos, you know, we apply these science concepts to how to reduce injuries in a crash, whether it's in race cars or in passenger vehicles. All right, so again, just like before with the crash science demos, we have some instructions, both for the students and the teachers. And remember, I said these are pretty content rich, you know, so that means the concepts are coming pretty quickly in the video. So we have a way for the students to organize these concepts. It's a sheet basically where they're filling in the blanks as they watch the movie. Okay, and these questions are the lower order questions, so they're really straightforward. And here's the running time where they come in the film, and they just film them as they watch the video. Now, important thing is that you need to stop the video every minute or two, or 2 to 3 minutes, so that they can get caught up. Otherwise, they'll get behind and frustrated, and they just won't do it. Then after the video, we have student discussion questions. These are higher order questions, require a little bit more thought. So teachers typically like to use these in small group discussion times, or assign them for homework. Students can take a little bit more time and have to, you know, delve through the video a little bit more deeply, or some other resource materials that the teacher has given them in order to answer the questions. I've put a lot here. Usually they don't do all of them. The teachers just pick or choose which ones they would like the students to do, what are the most age appropriate. Okay, and then of course, here are your answer keys that you can get to. For the concept organizer, you can see we've just filled in the blanks with the answers. Okay, so there are the videos with the three options how you can use them instructionally. Let's move down to the lessons and then do a quick overview. Now you can again scroll through them this way, but when I'm comparing the lessons to each other, trying to figure out which one I'm going to do, I like to go up to the top bar there, and then that way when you click on lessons, you see all 14 laid out. Okay, now, so which ones are good for middle school age, for grades 6 through 8? Well, let's pick those out. So we've got the first five here. So penny for your thoughts, pain in the neck, momentum bashing 1, momentum bashing 2, and the egg crash are all great for middle school. And then there are a couple more. I've got to go down here. The other two would be think fast and act fast is great for middle school, as well as distracted driving dangers.
All right. Thanks again for joining us today, folks. We've just taken a quick look at the IIHS-HLDI in the classroom website. Griff was just giving you a brief overview of all the different pieces to it, including demonstration videos, hands-on activities, some longer length videos. We want to take just a couple quick questions that we've had coming in, and then we're actually going to, I think in a second, Griff, we're going to hop in and we're going to look closer at one of those activities in particular. But just a couple quick questions before we do that. Someone was asking what sort of supplies you might need to do some of these activities.
Well, we've got 14 activities now, just added 3 new ones, but 10 of the 14 activities use very simple, easy to find materials, most of which you can find around your house. You know, we're talking rulers, marbles, plastic cups, pennies, coat hangers, things of that nature.
Great. Yeah, and I think the one we're about to look at is a really basic one. It only requires a couple items from around the house. Just before we jump in and take a closer look at what each of the activities has, I wanted to ask you what your favorite activity is, or is there one that you particularly enjoyed creating?
Favorite activity. It would probably be the egg crash, where Design and Collision Safety Device is the name of the lesson. And the students are actually building a landing pad for the egg to fall on. So I think a lot of people have heard of and remember, maybe even did when they were in school, the egg drop, where they're building something around the egg. But in this case, they're just dropping a raw egg, but they're trying to keep it from breaking by building the landing pad that it falls on. But it's got a little engineering twist to it. So they can't use any more than 10 sheets of paper and a meter of masking tape. And they have to build it with just those supplies in about 20 minutes. So that's one of my favorites. And I think I even touch on that in a little overview that we're gonna go through here in a minute. And it's definitely one for middle school. Well, actually I've done that lesson, the egg drop, all the way from fourth grade up to my college students were doing that, and everyone loved it.
That's great. Awesome. Well, we are going to take a close look at one of the activities. If you're just tuning in or just hopping on, my name is Joe Young. I'm with the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety. Griff Jones is joining me, and we're talking about the IIHS-HLDI in the Classroom website. This is a free resource that we actually designed really with teachers in mind, but given the current situation, these activities are really easy. Many of them are really easy to do at home. We think it's a great way to reinforce some core STEM concepts. So, Griff, which one are we going to take a close look at right now?
The very first is called Penny for Your Thoughts on Inertia.
All right, Penny for Your Thoughts on Inertia. All right, should we take a look?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right.
There's an overview of the 14 lessons. Let's do a little deeper dive into one so we can see their format. All right, so again, if you scroll down, you'll see first start off with the introduction that the students can watch to get an overview of the activity. It's always fairly quick. This one's less than a minute. I'd encourage you to scroll down or have the students scroll down first. If they're doing it just on their own, tell them to go to the student directions, and they're going to want to print out the student activity sheet, either there or over here. So let's do that. Here's a student activity sheet for paying for your thoughts. You can see it's only 2 pages, so that's nice. They have their analysis questions. So takes them through the procedure. There are all the supplies. But as the person that may guide them through this lesson, you're going to want to go to the teacher area, and you'll see the lesson steps. And there, I recommend the first thing you do is download the teacher lesson plan. Okay, you can do it again on that link or up here. And all the teacher lesson plans follow the same format. Key questions, grade levels, objectives, correlation to the national standards. And then I give you some background information on the topic that they're going to be studying. And then give you step-by-step instructions on how to conduct it, you know, with your student, okay? And then, probably most importantly, there are the answers to this analysis questions from the student sheet. Okay, now, but before you do the activity, really encourage you to scroll down a little further in the teacher section and you will see our teacher tips video. All right, this gives you a nice overview of the lesson and any safety features that may be needed. So let's take a listen.
Welcome to Teacher Tips for Penny for Your Thoughts on Inertia. In this activity, students get a real feel for inertia. So let's go over the activity. First, we have it. Teacher lesson plan has the objectives and some of the key questions for you to ask, and also student activity sheet front and back. So the materials, very simple. Start with a plastic cup, any size will work, 3x5 card, and a stack of pennies. So the challenge is for students to remove the card from out from under the penny using only one finger. I start with one penny, which is actually more difficult than a stack of pennies because it has less mass, therefore less inertia. Now, two most common techniques to get the card out from between the cup and the penny using only one finger is the flick method or just kind of the sweeping method, like that. Now, for older students, you want to give them a little bit more of a challenge. You can ask them to do it without the cup, but to take a penny and put it on their finger, and then sandwich another smaller piece of a 3x5 card, or even better, I like to use a business card because they're a little bit stiffer, and then stack the pennies on top. Again, starting with one is more difficult, so I'm actually going to put two or three here. And then the same method, they have to use one finger to remove the card from out from under the stack. Okay, one, two, and three. Ha! All right, have fun.
So there, we've done that for every activity. So hopefully you'll find that helpful. I would recommend you start there first if you're going to help the students go through the activity. All right, and then once they've done the activity and they're starting to answer the analysis questions, they may need a little help when it comes to the concept of inertia. So one thing you can do is here's the video segment from the It's Basic Physics film, instead of you having to go back to the first part of the web page and find that inertia segment, we've included it for you right here. It's a couple of minutes 2 minutes, 28 seconds long. Then we've included the conclusion video. So let me just show you the first few seconds of this one.
How'd you do? That was 25 pennies. Did you observe that it was easier with a stack of pennies than with just one penny? Why is that? Well, stack of pennies has more inertia. How do we measure inertia? By its mass. So the more massive something is, the more inertia it has. So why is it that it was easier when it had more inertia? Well, let's look at it. So when I stack the pennies up there, nice stack, has a decent mass to it, that means it has a greater tendency to remain at rest, right? That's inertia. Objects at motion tend to stay in motion. Objects at rest tend to stay at rest unless acted upon by an outside force.
Let's stop that there. You get the idea. So once you're done there, then again, you can even move on to one of the next activities. I did scaffold them so that we started sort of the most basic concept and inertia and Newton's laws of motion and applied that in pain in the neck. And then we moved to momentum, but you don't have to do them in order, just kind of based upon, you know, your child's ability level and where they are at the school, what they're working on, whether they're in eighth grade and they're taking a physical science class, or whether it's seventh grade and it's more sort of a life sciencey stuff. The life sciencey lessons are more down here, sort of like the think fast and act fast and the distracted driving. More physical science lessons are here with the laws of motion and momentum and so on. Finally, kind of to wrap things up here, just like to say all of the components of this site, from the videos to the lessons to the, you know, the engagement videos down here, everything has been developed on the proven research on what's effective for inquiry-based learning.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back. We hope you enjoyed that deep dive into Penny for your thoughts on inertia. That's one of 14 lessons available on the IIHS-HLDI in the classroom website. Again, this is a free website that we designed over several years, and it's great for parents that are looking for quality, and I think free, that's very important, quality education materials online to help augment some of the teaching from home that we're all doing. So Griff Jones is joining me. He's the guy who helped design all of this. And Griff, we're going to take just a couple questions about the site. Folks, if you have questions while you're watching, please drop them in the comments section on Facebook or that chat window on YouTube, and we'll get to as many as we can here. So Griff, this question I actually really like, which is, and you may have covered it a little bit earlier, but did you do any of these activities in your classrooms when you were teaching?
Oh, yes. Yes, I did almost every single one of them. I wrote all the lessons, but all of the lessons have had extensive input from engineers, not only engineers, obviously, at the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety, but engineers from the University of Florida. We've had, you know, college education professors, physics professors, physicians, not only at our university, but locally and nationally, that we've asked opinions and get advice on. Not only did I do them, but most of these lessons have been field tested by classroom teachers out there from grades 5 through 12. So, I've done most of them over my 20 years of teaching, not only with my high school physics kids, but as I mentioned earlier, I was at a K-12 school. And so I taught not only high school physics most of the time every day, but also I worked with the elementary age kids, grades 3, 4, and 5 primarily. And so what lessons I could do at that age level, I did. So yeah, these lessons have all been teacher reviewed and classroom tested.
All right. Well, yeah, it sounds like they've gone through quite the review process. A lot of folks have done these. And a lot of folks were involved with creating these activities. This question I like because this is a hot topic. Someone asked about distracted driving, if there's any activities that kind of focus on distraction, especially with teens. This is a big issue. Do we have any activities that look at that?
We sure do. It's called Distracted Driving Dangers. And I mentioned it in the little tour overview. This is a perfect one for middle school age students, but also I've done it at the high school level. I've even done it in with my college students. And so it's one where, just real briefly, it's one where we try to simulate the different types of distractions that you can encounter that have been documented in the research, whether it's a manual distraction, like, you know, playing with a radio, or whether it's a mental distraction where you're just thinking about something else. So any of those sort of distractions that you do other than paying attention to the road. So we came up with some ways to sort of simulate each of those types of distractions in the classroom. And the instead of driving, what they're doing is they're doing something we call a touch track. So it's used to be called a finger maze. This actually came from my wife, who was also a high school teacher before she became a science education professor. But she used it with her students, where you go through and there's, like, on the page, there's a sheet of paper. There's numbers 1 through 25 in a random sort of order on the page. And the driver in the activity, the student has to go through and locate the numbers and touch it with their finger. Okay. And then with their other hand, they're being just, they have to do the distraction. So if it's a manual distraction, like it would be on a radio in the car, what they're having to do in the simulation is they're, while they're doing the touch track, trying to go as quickly as they can and find 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and work their way through the touch track. The other hand is, say, is in a bowl of Chex Mix that's got peanuts in it. And they have to feel around, grab the peanuts out of the Chex Mix while they're doing the 1 through 25 and put it in another bowl. And the whole time they're doing that, they're being timed by their partner to see how long it takes them to do that. And then before they even try to be distracted, they have to see how fast they can do it without any sort of distractions. And then they compare those two times, the undistracted time to get through the maze compared to the distracted time to get through the maze. So it's a lot of fun. And again, we've done it. I've done it as early as fifth grade, all the way up through college students. And it's always been a big hit. And the point is, they see that you should not be distracted while you drive.
Right. That sounds like a pretty fun time. And it kind of hits an important point about distraction, which is there's not just one type, right? It's not just exactly on your cell phone. Everything you're doing behind the wheel, eating, drinking, playing with the radio, that's all different types of distraction. Well, that's cool. So distracted driving dangers, that's the one to go to if you're interested in learning about that.
And the only materials, to answer one back to your other question, people are worried about materials. Only thing that they're required is to print the sheets out. You know, once they download the activity from the website, they just print out the sheets. They need the timer, which they can use from on their phone timer or whatever. And then just some supplies that they, I'm sure, find around the house to act as a distraction. So that's it. They don't have to buy anything.
Right. And that's a really good point to hit. These are designed for classroom use, but we can do them around the house pretty easily because they really don't require a whole lot other than, like you said, you've got the PDFs, you know, print them off and you're good to go. So just a couple more questions. Again, we appreciate everyone tuning in to learn about the site, which, by the way, when we're done here, we'd encourage you to go check it out. It's classroom.iihs.org. One really important point I'll hit is that there's a feedback button there. So if you like the site or if there's something you would want to see added to the site, let us know. We're really excited. And that actually goes well with this next question, which is someone was asking if there's anything that's new on the site, since a few months ago.
Yes, we just added 3 new lessons. So we have the pain in the neck, which follows up on the lesson that I just talked about, Penny, for your thoughts on inertia. So it talks about inertia and what happens in a rear end collision. And then another one is twirling Penny. This was one that we used to do in the classroom from fifth graders on up, and it was a blast. But twirling Penny, you just have to make sure you have some safety goggles around, because what you're trying to do is twirl a penny on the tip of a coat hanger, right? With your finger, twirling it around in the air. Which you can do, it takes some patience, but man, the coat hangers go flying, the pennies go flying. So if they're going to try that one at home, they definitely need to make sure they put on some safety glasses. And then the last one we did was a culminating activity called Project Pedestrian. But that one's more for a lab that has some computer sensors. But those first two definitely could do at home. Middle school age would be the sweet spot for those. So yeah, that and Something else that's new in this last month or so is that we've updated our very first video, the Understanding Car Crashes, Its Basic Physics. The original video came out years ago, and so we just updated with some new footage. The introduction's new, and then, but more importantly, we talk at the end, I interview the current president of the Institute and talk about what's the latest in their crash research program.
Very cool. Well, I'm glad you mentioned the videos, because someone was asking if the videos need to be watched before you can do the activities, or if it's all kind of standalone.
No, you don't have to. And in fact, I did my dissertation research on that. It doesn't matter if you do the activities first or watch the video first. But it has my research did show that doing them together, though, doing both of them, it doesn't matter which order, really helps increase the students' learning. And the way we've got the website designed now, and we've added so much more material than just the initial two Understanding Car Crash videos and the hands-on activities. Now we have a lot more content. We've got the crash science demo videos. We have some really cool high-interest videos, like the crash between the 50-year-old Bel Air and the 2009 Malibu. That's such a really high-interest video. We have the video of all the behind-the-scenes tour, the inside IIHS. All of those are great videos. You could actually start there with one of those videos to hook the students' attention. The teachers know that as an engagement sort of phase of the lesson, to get the students interested in whatever topic they're going to study before they get deep into the content or even actually do the hands-on activity. So it's something that's called in our science education lingo, an inquiry-based learning. That's called the 5E instructional technique. And they want to know more about it. Parents want to learn more about the 5E instructional technique. We've got in our FAQs up the top of the website, they can pull down and they'll see we explain what that learning cycle and each phase is in the 5E approach. So no, you can mix it around. Again, what we're trying to do is entertain as well as inform. So, first you got to hook the students' attention. So sometimes the best thing to do is show them a really cool video that's short and sweet, but gets them interested more about crash worthiness and crash safety. And then once they're interested, do the activity. And then I want to learn more about inertia or energy or potential energy or kinetic energy, whatever it may be. Then you could actually go to the Understanding Car Crash videos and pull out that segment and watch that. So all sorts of different options.
Yeah, right, exactly. So you can kind of just dive in and see what works best for how much time you've got and so forth. So Griff, this has been really helpful, I think, for a lot of parents out there that are looking for quality activities to do with their kids. I'm getting on the comments section on YouTube. We've got a lot of questions coming in about IIHS as well, and a love for what we do. And you can definitely check out our website if you're in the market for a car and you want to review safety ratings. I should mention IIHS.org. Someone did ask Griff, and I'll just ask you what kind of car you're driving.
Well, right now I'm sitting in my Ford F-250. Which I don't actually drive that often, but my wife and I have a camper, so we pull with the big Ford F-250. But probably the better question is, what car does my wife drive? And so she drives an Acura MDX most of the time, which is an SUV. The reason we bought that was because it got great crash ratings, particularly the small overlap crash rating. They got the first high ratings on that. And I went, that's the car I want my wife driving. So.
Well, there you go. There you go. So if you're looking for safety ratings for the Acura MDX or anything else, IIHS.org. But again, if you're interested in high quality resources to teach at home, classroom.IIHS.org. We should reiterate, it's totally free to use. And right now, teachers and parents can access the teaching guides, the lesson plans, and so forth. And Griff, is there anything else you want to add about the site before we sign off here?
So here are the teaching guides. If they want to download the whole guides, except for the brand new lessons, they're not in here yet, but they can see down at the bottom, if they're logged in, the parents, this is important, parents have to register and then log in, like we reviewed in the first half of our little tour. They've got to log in order to get to the teacher activity guides. But at the end of every lesson page, down below the teacher tip videos and everything, they'll see at the bottom of each page where if they would like to just download both entire books, they can do that. They're free. They're PDF files. They can actually manipulate the lessons if they want to decide what fits their age level student. So I encourage them to do that. And the other three lessons, they can print it also. But again, these lessons are all for inquiry-based learning. So that's hands-on learning where the kids are asking the questions. It's perfect for these home experiences. I encourage the parents to try this. You don't have to know all the answers either, parents, okay? So the whole point about inquiry-based learning is to let the students' curiosity drive that learning process. And so instead of feeling like you have to know all the answers, okay, you can be the guide on the side. You're helping them through to understand and discover the natural world of science and these important concepts that we're dealing with that are very relevant, to crash safe. So don't be afraid, dive in and watch the teacher tip videos. They'll help you through and answer a lot of the questions. So good luck.
Wow. All right, that's great information. Thank you, Griff, so much for joining us. Everyone, classroom.ihs.org. And please spread the word if you know other parents looking for quality STEM science learning resources. Thank you all, and have a wonderful Monday.
Thank you. Stay safe, everyone.